गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः सो वी आर हियर इन सिडनी एट आवर मैथिली एंड चंद्रशेखर्स हाउस फॉर सदाचार रिट्रीट सदाचार इज द स्पिरिचुअल कंडक्ट वन इनिशिएट्स और practices in life in order to come to be the truth. Not know the knowing and being is one, to be the truth. And we see that we as man, man is out of ignorance getting involved in the world, complaining, running away. But what is he seeking in the end from the world? What is he seeking? Happiness, contentment, he wants bliss, he wants joy. That is his purpose of interacting with the world. But he is failing to understand, and that what he is seeking, he already is. And in this way, he makes many bits of his own by identifying with so many different things in the world, with identifying with so many desires in himself, and says, if this desire is fulfilled, I'll be complete. If this desire is fulfilled, I'll be complete. If this desire is fulfilled, I'll be complete. And this way, running from pillar to post, from object to object, from desire to desire, from relation to relationship, he is trying to fill himself up. But he is forgetting to understand that what he wants to fill himself up with, he already is. Then I go to temple, I go to pilgrimages, I go to do lot of sadhana, I do lot of pranayam, I do everyday morning sandhya, I do lighting the lamp, I chanted 108 names to put the flowers around the feet of the god. Then why this shift is not coming? After 30, 40, 50 years, depending, find out which category you fall in. After following it for so many years, still why there seems to be an emptiness within our heart? Why don't we feel full? And Adi Shankaracharya, this text is attributed to Adi Shankaracharya, who was born in the 8th century. And it is not a very common text among other texts which we have seen of Adi Shankaracharya. Some of you have met Anubhavananji. So when he was studying the Vedanta course, that time in the library he found it. And that too it was in Marathi. And then he searched and searched and searched, and he found the English translation somewhere. Sanskrit verses for it. And then this is the only book that he has written. Rest of them, people have written it for him. Means they take the talks, and then there is a big team of volunteers who transcribe the talks of his and then put it, and he edits it. But this is the only book he wrote. Even Panchadashi, it has come like that only. He only edited it and corrected wherever it is required. So this is one of the Prakaran Granthas. Prakaran Granthas means what? It helps you to the basics of our scriptures. When we use the word Vedanta, we think it is argumentation, it means logicalization, it means analysis. Vedanta is not equal to that. Then what is Vedanta? I asked the same question at Robin's house the other day, last satsang. What is Vedanta?
Vedanta, end of knowledge.
End of knowledge. who brings you this end of knowledge?
Yourself.
Huh? True. But empirically speaking, the scriptures. But which scriptures? Vedas. Which part of Vedas? The Upanishad part of the Vedas is called Vedanta. Because every Upanishad concludes in annihilating everything that it has just taught. Meaning, dissolving all words. Upanishads are nothing but words. Vedas are words. So as long as the word is there, till then separation will be there from the word. So what are the Upanishads? They are direct indicators of the truth. Direct indicators of that Paramatma. And that's all they can do. They cannot take you and deliver you there. Then you have to take those words and get established in that which those words are indicating. And what are the words indicating? You are that. That is the Mahavakya, isn't it? Tattvamasi, you are that. I am Brahma, I am Atma Brahma. This Atma is Brahma. Prajnanam Brahma. This knowledge is Brahma. Brahma is of the nature of knowledge. And Aham Brahmasmi, I am that. And in this way, scriptures are giving you a pointer. These are all pointers. But these pointers have to be realized in yourself, as yourself. Not objectively. And this is the biggest problem in our life, in the life of a seeker. That over lifetimes and in this life, since we are born, we are made to learn objectively. We are not made to learn experientially. Nobody has told us till today that we are that which we are seeking. Oh, you have to go to school to become someone. Oh, you have to become doctor to survive. I think out of all the professions, doctor is the good profession. Because continuous patients will come. See?
But we also need a lot of people who have actually experienced it to talk about their own experiences.
Good. Very good point. Reality is not an experience. Self is not an experience. Experience, I can experience this water because it is separate to me and I can make it one with me. I can have an experience of this watch because I am not this watch, but when he gave me the watch, I can have the experience of the texture, I can have the experience of its look. How can you have experience of your own self? Can you experience your own eyes?
Yes.
No, 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 wait. If eyes are looking at the whole world and cognizing it, can the eyes look at themselves and cognize?
But the brain knows.
No, I'm not talking about brain, I'm talking about eyes. Stay with the point. Can the eyes look at themselves? No. But you know, eyes exist, isn't it? Huh?
Through mirror they can see.
No, but there is no
reflection.
In the self there is no mirror, my friend. We are talking about principle. We are not, these examples I am taking is only to bring your attention to that unknowable principle, yet it is your direct experience. Unknowable through the mind, but directly experienced as the self. Directly experienced is not equal to experience of this watch or experience of the food. Or experience of the body, or experience of that water, or experience of anything in this creation is an objective experience. You can experience your body as an objective experience. You can experience your breath. What does objective experience entail? That the observer must be other than the observed, the thing or being observed. So observer must be different. So you know body is, you are other than the body. You know breath is, you are other than the breath. You know mind is, you are other than the mind. You know the senses are, you are other than the senses. And now you want to say, I am also. But how can you make separate yourself from yourself? You can't see yourself, the consciousness, the life force, the life that is throbbing through you as separate to yourself, because you are that life. And this is the mistake every human being, or I should say, in this our today's context, every seeker is unable to give up this habitual objectification of the self. Then if this is the problem, I understand, yesterday we were talking, we understand everything and yet it is not clicking, yet it is not, I'm not abiding in that self. I know I am, there's no doubt about it. Then why am I not able to abide in it? Why am I not able to be steady in that experience? Experience, less experience, okay, let me correct it. Why?
Attached.
Huh?
So attached.
No, you understand everything. You know you are the self. You know I am the observer. Then why can't you remain as the eternal witness?
We have to change our brain then.
Brain is only an equipment, sir. It's only a physical equipment through which mind functions. If there is no physical brain, mind will not be able to function in this body. Such people are called vegetable. Many times they get the short circuit in their system and brain fries. Some people whose kundalini has risen, the brain fries. And they are alive, but good for nothing. Because why? The neural networks have all got fried. But you need the brain, just like a car has all the components, but horsepower which makes the car move is an you cannot experience it, yet it is there as a result of the functioning of all the parts, isn't it? But if you don't have the parts, will the horsepower be there? As a principle, it will be there. As a principle, it will be still functioning in other cars. But in our car, it will not be there. Why? Components are missing. Same way, in our body, brain is the component where the engine is going on, of the mind, and it facilitates the manifestation of the mind. So when people say that brain is the mind, brain is not the mind. See, my grandfather, when he used to sit in meditation, there will be no breath, there will be no heartbeat at 84 years of age. That's what prompted me to seek further. No breath, no heartbeat. And I checked, and that day I cancelled my work and I sat. When he came out, I made porridge for him, and suddenly newfound devotion for him. He used to make porridge for me every day before I used to go to work. That day I kept the porridge ready. And he got up. Hey, you made the porridge? Okay, no problem. All beard and like a yogi. I said, now I want to ask you something. He said, what? Where were you? I checked. No heartbeat. When did you check? He didn't even know that I had touched him. I took one hair off of my head, put it under his nose, hardly any breath. I said, where were you? I want to know. I want to find out. That day itself, I got initiated by him. That day itself, I didn't waste time. Are we hungry for it?
Not as much.
No, don't answer. You, otherwise everyone will come to know.
You asked, right? Yeah.
Questions are asked for
it. It's not a discussion.
Yes.
But you can ask questions, no problem. So are we that hungry? Is that urge so over-consuming that enough is enough? It's time. How long am I going to live in this default mode? Get up in the morning, take my shower, eat, drink my coffee, have my breakfast, and then when that is done, then I'll sit for my sadhana. And then, oh my God, it's a bit hot, I need fan. And then, oh, it's cold, I need heater. I think if I wear pants, it is uncomfortable. I think I'm going to wear lungi today. Then, is it polyester lungi? No, I must wear cotton lungi. Oh, is it white? No. When I meditate, I am a sannyasi, so I should wear a ochre sulungi. How many things we are lost in? How many things? A person who is really hungry or who is really thirsty, they don't care what quality of water is there. They will first drink it and then take medicine afterwards. Because you are thirsty. You need to satiate your hunger, thirst. You need to satiate your hunger. So we all understand what our goal is. We all understand intellectually that self is the goal and I am that self. But our problem is of being steady in that understanding, in that experienceless experience. Whatever we have come to know, we are forgetting that whatever we know, we are. This is where we are missing the point.
Being steady.
Being steady in the self as the self.
How would you know if you're steady?
That's when you know. That's when you know. And you don't need to know. As a objective experience. All knowing is in the mind. All knowing is in the mind. Once you are, mind has got dissolved into the self, then there's no need to know. Because whatever the knowing was going on, objective pursuit, it was only to get to this point, isn't it? Now when it has happened, then there's nothing else. Then there's no doubt. Then there's no confusion. Then there's no seeking. Then there's no sadhana. Then there are no scriptures. Because embodiment of all these things, you are. See? So, what can we do? In different ways, Shankaracharya has directed the minds of the seekers in different texts. In Bhaj Govindam, he has taken the stance that how rare is this human birth? Don't waste it. Utilize it. Agrevanni prushte bhanu angam galitam tundam dhoyam. Or getting living for your relationships. And there he brings our attention that all relationships are for your own sake. Everyone is with you only as long as you have money. The moment you don't have it, they will all leave you one by one. You don't believe it? Try it out. Try it out. So the entire Bhaj Govindam is bringing to the seeker's mind that this idea that don't waste your human birth. Then what is the purpose of human birth? Yesterday this point came in our Saxena ji's house. What is the purpose of human birth? Is it to marry? Is it to have children? Is it to be involved in grandchildren? No, all that is secondary. Main purpose of human birth in that Bhaj Govindam or any other scripture is impressing on our mind is to realize that you are that which you are seeking. That is the purpose of human birth. Don't get distracted by anything. And this is what our Gurukul system used to do once upon a time, and then they used to leave you alone. Then they leave you off the leash. Then if there is a desire to go into the family life, you will go into the family life, yet you will continue the pursuit of the truth without feeling the guilt that I think I have fallen because I got married. There's no fall possible. But we create our own guilts by interacting with the situations wrongly. Then if someone has taken sannyas path, he has withdrawn from the world, and is pursuing the truth, he also doesn't feel guilt that, oh my God, at least, I should have got married and then run away. No. He is also comfortable. See? So, in this text, it is like this. But here, in our Sadachar, the angle that Shankaracharya has taken is that of Sat Achar. Sat is the existence. Sat is the truth. Everything is. tree is, house is, fan is, camera is, you are, I am, world is, God is. This isness is the common factor pervading the entire creation. And that existence is Sat. That existence is Sat. Sat, Sadachar, no? If you break it up, Sat, Achar. Some person said Achar. So, existence is pickle. No, Achar. Achar means conduct, the spiritual conduct. If Sat is all that there is, if Sat is the substratum of the entire creation, and Sat is one without a second, there is no two existences. But see how we believe, I exist, you exist. And immediately we have accepted exist two existences. Now when I look at so many people, I say so many people exist. In the back of our mind, we have given validity to different things and beings as existing independently to the self. This is where we are making the mistake. And Upanishads tell us, and this text will also take us in that direction, that how, whatever you do 24 hours a day, how long ever may you live, this existence is independent of time, space and objectivity. It's independent. Nothing can corrupt it. Nothing can influence it. The problem is when, well, we'll come to the chit afterwards, then we will tell you that. The problem is this, who I think I am, is identified with the existence which I have broken up into so many and then gets identified with it. And then complains. I don't want the loss of my dear one. I don't, oh, that camera, it was such an expensive one and you pushed it, you broke it. Identification. It is my camera, don't touch it. So Sat is that which is in and through pervading everything. And how do you know Sat? How do you know existence? Can you know existence as existence without knowing it? Then comes Chit. Chit means knowledge. I am existence, Sat. I know I am Chit. This knowledge is also existing. This knowledge is also existing. If you say we give the reality or God the name Sat Chit Ananda, isn't it? So, is Sat, Chit, Ananda three? Are they separate from each other? Are they three different qualities of the truth? Are they three different attributes of the truth?
No.
Not possible. Now we'll see why. So, Sat is the common denominator behind everything that is existing. Okay? And when we say everything, we are talking relatively. Absolutely, there is only one. So when we are talking word everything, it is the relative existence. The substratum, the common denominator is Sat. I know everything exists and I know I exist. Immediately the Chit comes up, the consciousness. Without a table cannot say I know I exist. So what is missing there? The consciousness is missing. Consciousness is missing. So is it absent? Very careful. Is consciousness absent in the table? Is consciousness absent in the camera? Is consciousness absent in the bricks and stones of the earth?
No.
Then what is it?
It has no awareness.
Huh?
No awareness.
Okay, it's got no, that is consciousness. So is it absent? Is awareness absent? Okay, I'll give you another, see if you can work it out. Just when we began, we say mind can manifest through the brain. Can you think from your arm?
No.
Why? Can you think from your toes?
It's only an instrument, part of that.
No, instrument is okay, but why you cannot think by your fingers? Why can't you think by your hair? Why can't you think by your senses? Why only through brain? It's not a trick question, just little bit, just drop all understanding and it will come.
It's more subtle consciousness.
Yes, it is subtle, no doubt, consciousness is subtle. But what is the reason that thinking is not possible from the arm? When we say, I am thinking, we touch our forehead. When we say feeling, we touch our heart. Do we say, oh, I am thinking.
Oh,
I am feeling.
Of information.
It exists because of consciousness.
What?
All these things.
No, you are going in the
expression of the consciousness.
Good. Expression. So this hand is unable to express the manifestation of consciousness. Understand? So this is also conscious, but the table is too gross for the consciousness to express. In plant kingdom, consciousness is expressing, but not fully. In animal kingdom, it is expressing even more, but not enough to be self-aware. But in human beings, it expresses completely. And we have been given the opportunity that we can become self-aware. So either we can live like an inert table, being a human being, those slobs, or we can be like a tree, lying in the bed for till 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock. Can I get some tea? Can I get breakfast in bed? Can I get lunch also? I think they say, Gangecha, Yamune, Chaiva, Godavari, Saraswati, take some water. No need of taking bath. Mantra bath we have taken. And then 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock, these kids will get up and then their day begins. And at night they have a problem. Why don't I get sleep at night? If you get up early, you will get sleep at night. See? So, conscious, we are living like animal, where consciousness is also expressing in animal kingdom. But what is the natural default mode of the animals? Security, procreation, and afterwards, detachment and aha.
And reaction,
that's instinctive. So are we living at that level? Only trying to secure our house, secure our future, take enough insurances, get enough cameras around so that I can protect my wealth that I have got, that I have produced. See? And then animal kingdom, they come with the opposite partner, they produce the children, and after producing the children, they let go of the children the moment they are able to forage food for themselves. They train the children and then they let them go. Human being, listen,
humans are more fragile.
No. Because the capacity to expand your mind, the expand the abilities, expand the knowledge base is only present in the human kingdom, not in the animal kingdom. Yes, physically they may be strong, but I can show you people just through pranayam, even an elephant cannot move them. They are still present today. One of our brahmacharis was like that.
But if we send 10-year-old
say that
child,
again?
If we send 10-year-old child, still go and live by yourself.
Did we say that? Anywhere I have mentioned that? No.
I'm asking.
No, don't imagine. You understand the principle that we are trying to bring out. The principle is consciousness is manifesting, and in inert matter, consciousness is not manifesting. In human being, it has the potential to express in its fullest. And human being is the crux of the creation, is the bestest creation among the creation. Then what is the next So now, if that is our case, why are we living only at the animal level? Why are we only living at the security level? Why are we only living at the desire level? Why can't you make desire for survival and desire for progeny or desire for more wealth, which is the first three chakras, and change it into desire to merge into the divine? That option is given to only human beings, not to the animal kingdom. And the moment this person, this seeker, comes to recognize that, yes, I am conscious, I want to be more than what I am today. Every day I must. Nature, yes, where was it? I think it was in the other day, that by nature we are being propelled to be more. But because of our overdue importance to security, desires and accumulation, the first three chakras, we do not allow ourselves to grow. Otherwise, every 7 years, you will grow higher and higher and higher. By age, 49, you should be realized. Yes. 49. Each chakra opens up every 7 years. Naturally. Every 7 years, one knot opens up. And where are we left? Where are we till today? Still in the first one, second one, or the third one. We have not grown. We are, by age we are grown, but maturity, wisdom comes only when you are in sync with the creation. No, they open completely, but they become partial open because of your insistence that I have to secure my life, I have to desire, live at the desire level, which is the second chakra, and desire at the, live at the accumulation level, which is the Manipur chakra. And we don't want to come to the heart level. Why? It's an unknown area. Suddenly you find at the heart level, you are consciousness, you are not the matter. And it's scary. Changes have to take place within you. And it becomes a self-propelled journey after that. God keeps pulling towards you, and you are still pulling yourself towards the world. Now neither you are of the world nor you are of the God. You confused me. People become depressed. This is the reason of depression, because you are not able to find your true place. Your true place is at this particular juncture in life of all of us. The true place is within ourselves, as ourselves. Because we are all about, you are not 49, no? She's got another 2-3 years to go. Seven? My God, last chakra has to open up. But when you start observing this in life, it's so, everything is there to help us to experience the beingness of ourselves. And yet all frictions, all memories that we are, because of our wrong interaction with the world, are creating the confusions, the maze we are creating by our own will, by our own desires. All we have to do is change our attention. And this is what scriptures tell us, the Upanishads tell us, shift your attention. Shift your attention from the world to the conscious principle. Now think, see, we started with Sat and Chit. So Sat is the common denominator. Chit is I know, I exist. Now, if people say, no, Sat Chit are separate, it cannot be so. If Sat is existence, and if Chit is separate to Sat, existence, it will become non-existence. Then Chit will become non-existence. How can non-existence come to no existence? It's not possible. See? And if you say Chit is separate to Sat, Sat is existence, and Chit is consciousness. Okay. If you say Chit is Asat, then you, consciousness will become inert. That is also not possible. And therefore, the scriptures bring us to this point that Sat is Chit and Chit is Sat. To bring this to our and then, of course, the third part is Ananda. The moment right now, food exists. I know the food exists. I am hungry, I want the food. The moment food becomes one with me, there is expression of bliss, Ananda. I exist, I know I exist. And when knowing and being become one within myself, as myself, that very moment, Ananda, the bliss expresses. Then how can you live your day on a daily basis? Here, so that this comes about. It is not a result. So here too, throughout all the verses, two standpoints will be taken. Three standpoints we can say. First standpoint is that of an ignorant person who is not even aware that the other two standpoints are there. Second is the standpoint of the seeker. Seeker is continuously striving, putting efforts through karma yoga, dhyan yoga, japa and sadhana, etc., etc., to reach a particular disposition. And third is the wise man, who is already established in it. So when we go through this, I don't have to take the first part, we know. So we'll take the standpoint of the seeker, what he should do. And every event that is coming here in the first 13-14 verses, we'll see how he spends the day, a particular seeker, because he's so sincerely, like you do sandhya, for example. So you are so diligently, every morning you get up, you do the sandhya. What is the meaning of sandhya for a seeker? And what is the meaning of sandhya for a wise man? Ignorant will forget because he doesn't do it. So what are the two standpoints? So how can you convert your sandhya into an expression of reality at that moment? Because reality can be experienced directly here and now, not afterwards. By doing sandhya, by doing japa, and one day I will come to know the truth, forget it. You can take many lifetimes. It will not happen. It has to happen. This shift in our understanding, shift in our consciousness, shift in our standpoint must happen, that we are able to recognize that which we are seeking, it is in spite of everything. And so with this thought, introduction, we enter into the text proper. Sadacharaha Satchidananda Kandaya
Jagadankura Hetave
Sadoditaya Purnaya
Namo Anantaya Vishnave.
It says, the salutations to the Supreme Self, which is of the nature of the Absolute Satchitananda, which is eternal, all-encompassing, indestructible. Salutations to the primordial cause of the sprout of the world, which is all-pervasive. Satchitananda, these three words, they are the Swarupa Lakshana. They are talking about the truth as it is. But truth is not just transcendental. What realization of the truth or the self is equal to knowing that you are transcendental and knowing that this whole creation, which is so real to me right now, is nothing but I. When this two side, both the sides become one, then it is realization. And this happens, the inkling of it comes in the Anahat Chakra. And as you move upwards, Till here, you have got no doubt you are the I. Between here and here, the whole transformation takes place. So, we are essentially the transcendental. We are transcendental to the entire creation. Where is the creation? In our mind. Right? And knowing this, 110%, that the creation cannot be without I. And it is the expression of I alone. Then alone realization is complete. Example. Water is the individual. Taking the position, wave. Wave is the individual. Taking the position of the water, that I am the wave is contemplating, that I am essentially the water. Then why are you calling wave? Why do you feel you are separate to other waves? Why do you pray to the ocean, the God? Out of ignorance. But once it comes to know that it is the water, what will be the essential nature, what will be the understanding of water? If we can put words to it, water will have no understanding. There is no mind there. But what will be the understanding? That I am all that there is. I am transcendental to ocean and waves. Yet, ocean and wave are supported by me, even though I am transcendental to both of them. When this understanding comes to us with respect to the creation, that this whole creation, this comes in the 9th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. 5th or the 6th verse? 6th.
Yes, 6th also. Sarvabhutasyam yoma bhajat ekatvam astitah. Sarvata vartamano api.
I don't have the Bhagavad Gita. I don't remember. It's okay. Point, I'm not worried about the verse. I'm more about what it is indicating. It says the whole world is in me. I am in the whole world in the first verse. Second verse it says, neither the world is in me nor I am in the world. Yet I support the whole world by being transcendental to the whole world. Now it's contradiction after contradiction. It is that way. Can you have a snake without a rope? You know the Vedantic example. Can you experience a snake without a rope?
No.
Not possible.
Yeah,
not possible. When the, from the rope's point of view, is there a snake? No. From the rope's point of view, there is no snake. Yet you are seeing the snake. And you are seeing the snake because there is a rope. Same way. So, where is the whole problem? Where is the whole world? It is existing on the self. It is superimposed on the self. So the process here, the first part, Satchidananda Kandaya. Kandaya means unity. Unity of Sat and Chit and Ananda. These three coming together is called as Kandaya. That is the first part. That is the transcendental, that is the Swarup, that is the essential nature, and that is its quality, Satchidananda. But we cannot deny the world. Therefore, Jagat Ankura Hetave, that it is the Jagat Ankura, it is from which the world has sprouted out. So, some people say the world has come out of the Maya. And many people keep saying, oh, Maya is too hard to give up. But don't you ever sit back and take a cup of tea and contemplate, can Maya exist independently? Can Maya exist independently? Where at it? Another word for Maya is Prakriti, another word for it is ignorance. Another word for ignorance, according to Jnaneshwar Maharaj, is incomplete knowledge. So where does Maya or Prakriti come from? Has it appeared by itself? If it has appeared by itself, then there will be two existences. One is Sat and one is Maya is Asat. So it has, when you get up in the morning, where do you get up from? Come from outside, you enter into the world. No, from yourself only the consciousness is expressing. So same way, the expression of Maya, the expression of potentiality appears from within that reality. And when does it appear? When the reality or Brahman becomes aware of itself. It is ever complete. How many times during the day do you say, I am the body? How many times do you say? Hardly, isn't it? But the day you say it, suddenly, oh, I think I got pain there. Oh, I think I got a headache. Oh, I think my back has got a, some catch. Immediately other things start coming. You become aware of, isn't it? But your body before also, your body now also, before you were living in default mode, you are not thinking about the body. Now you are thinking about the body. So imagine, Brahman is all that there is, and the moment he becomes aware, just like when you wake up in the morning, early in the morning, what is the first thought that comes to your mind? I am. You don't say, I have to catch a train. First, eyes are closed, you are still lying in the sleeping position, and you know you are awake. Eyes have not opened yet. You are absolutely aware of the breath that is taking place. You are aware of what position you are. Then slowly, slowly, you become aware of the breath, then the body, then the bed. And slowly, slowly, the mind starts expanding. Isn't it? Automatic it begins every morning. And every night, everything gets absorbed. Every morning, everything starts expanding. This is creation. So where has creation come from? Yes, creation is an expression of ignorance. Because you did not know the rope, so the snake appeared. Because you do not know yourself as you are essentially, therefore the world is expressing for you. Individuality is expressing for you. See? And the moment we become aware, the potentiality starts expressing. And that potentiality then starts multiplying itself into the whole, as the whole creation. And Satchidananda Kandaya Jagadankura Hetave Sadoditaya Purnaya Namonantaya Vishnave. So third, second part, Sadotitaya. Sadotitaya means that it is this reality. It is not just of the nature of knowledge. Then what can else it be? If it is not only of the nature of knowledge? It is transcendental to knowledge and ignorance. It is transcendental to Jiva and Ishvara. It is transcendental to cause and effect. It is transcendental to permanent and impermanent. It is transcendental to time, space and objectivity. It is that principle which cannot be corrected by any opposites, any duality. Where does duality exist? In creation. And what is this? Sadoditaya, sada udita. The word is sada udita. Sada means always. Udita means always arising. Always arising. It is not said that after I finish my sadhana, it will arise. After my kundalini is opened, it will arise. It is not saying that. It is saying sada udita. It is ever arisen. It is ever, sprouting. It is ever like ever expressing. If I ask you one question, do you know last few days you were sleeping, you were dreaming, you were a waker? All of you will say yes. Isn't it? Yesterday were you a waker, dreamer, sleeper? Yes, I was. Day before yesterday, also I was the three. Day before, also. From childhood till now, yes, I know these three have come and gone. If these three have come and gone, why don't you remain as that person who is the witness of these three coming and going? Why do you become the waker in the waking plane? Why do you become the dreamer in the dream plane? Why do you become the sleeper in the sleeping plane, deep sleep plane? So we are selling ourselves short to ourselves. How? By getting identified with one state or the other. But what is our position? The moment I bring this example in front of you, that do you know the three states came and went yesterday, day before yesterday, day to day before yesterday? You say yes. That is your real position. So when you are speaking that, yes, I was awake, I know that these three came and went, at this moment that is your position. And that is reality. But very quickly, in an instant moment, because of our practice of identification, immediately that knowledge is again covered up by the waker, superimposition of the waker. Why? Our attention is on the conditionings. Our attention is on the security, desire, accumulation.
Deeply etched habit.
It's a habit. You have to create a new habit. So when we come to the scriptures, we create a new habit. Yesterday, you were not there. We were talking afterwards with James and other. That point came that nothing in your mind can be erased. All memories. So someone was saying, oh, we have to let go, oh, we have to give up. You cannot give up anything. You cannot let go anything. If you let go, you are reinforcing them in your mind by thinking about it, that I have to let go smoking. Mind does not understand let go. Mind understands smoking. Oh, he wants smoking. So you say, I want to let go smoking. Mind says, smoke, 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 smoke. I must get up. Every morning, I don't want to sleep. Mind says, sleep. Oh, here I come. It creates sleep. So all you can do as a seeker, this is where going, that you can create a new habit. And the new habit is that I am healthy. At this moment, from the context of this text, we have three, four options. Either we are ignorant, that is first option. Second option is we are a seeker. And the third option is we are all that there is. It's only taking the standpoint and then living as that, not compromising anywhere. So either I take myself to be a jiva who is identified with the world, or I take myself to be the total, the Ishvara or the Lord identity. And for that, what you will have to do? You will have to take the position of the God and see how ocean looks at the water, all the waves. You have to take that position. Or third position, I can be the water. I am one without a second. There is nothing else outside of me. See? Right now, I will give you an example. You are in this house. You are in this space. Is there something called inside space and outside space? Wherever you move on this planet, or in this solar system, or in the galaxies, you are still in the same space, isn't it? Then why do you call this a house space? Why do you call my bedroom space, and he calls his bedroom space, kitchen space, satsang space? Why? Space is space, then why are we calling it by different names? Because our attention is on the walls, conditionings. Our attention is not on space. So just like we move from room to room, but we are still in the house. We move from country to country, but we are still on Earth. We move from planet to planet, we are still in the solar system. We move from galaxy to galaxy, we are still in the creation. Isn't it? The total space. Exactly the same way. Wherever the wave moves, it's still in the ocean. Wherever the ocean goes, it's still in the water. It cannot exist without water. When you start taking, this is the shift in our, come. This is the shift. Let it be. You need a firm chair or a soft chair? Okay, you sit down and see. If not, you come to that chair afterwards.
Keep it nearby. You have a chair. Yeah, keep it.
Okay. So, where are we? Distracted. Flow is gone. Wherever we move in this space, in this world, we are still in the space. Now, if what is for the wave, now wave is starting to think that wherever I move, I am in water. Now, till it takes water to be separate to it, the wave is thinking the water is separate to me. What is realization for the wave? To become one with water. To become one with the ocean. How can it become one with the ocean by remaining separate to it? It has to wear the hat of the ocean and start thinking. What is the thinking? All waves are in me. Isn't it? So, but coming to this point, the penultimate standpoint is that wherever I go, I'm not outside of ocean. It is not possible. Ocean is expressing in and through me. I cannot be. Wherever the fish goes in the water, it is still in the water. Once that clicks, that inside and outside, the divinity is expressing, the reality is expressing. When I go with the ignorant, when I go with the knowledgeable people, the Mahatmas, or the worst of the worst, the animals, the plants, the inert matter, everything is nothing but that same reality, and that I am. Suddenly you are making it subjective. But to make it subjective and be established in it, a great amount of what is required? Dispassion is required. So both dispassion and knowledge. On one hand, you are collecting the knowledge by being the self, and on other hand, you are making the world have zero value in your mind. And how do you get the zero value? By seeing the emptiness of the world. By coming to this conclusion that throughout my life, I am trying to complete myself through this world, but till today it has not happened. I'm 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, whatever. But it has not happened. Enough. It's time to change. Let me try something else. Be an explorer of the self, not of the world. So can you stop going to pilgrimages? Can you stop going to temples? Can you stop doing your karmakand? No. Doing your pujas? No. Then what has to be done? The attitude behind all this has to change. And this is what Sadachar is going to present to us. So, Sadoditaya, Jagadankura Hetave, I have already told. And then, Purnaya, it is ever complete. It's ever complete. Space cannot come to know itself. Water cannot come to know itself. Gold cannot come to know itself. Rope cannot come to know itself. The world cannot come to know itself. There is someone who is knowing the world. Who is he? Who is that? I am. And this I am is independent of this world. Therefore he is knowing it, isn't it? Come to this conclusion and this is complete. It is permeating, it is all pervading, and therefore the word that they have used here is Vishnave. It's infinitely ever present, Anantaya and Vishnave. It is all Vishnu here means all pervading. So not only it is transcendental, but it is also all pervasive in this creation. Continuing. Now, the Anubandha Chatushtaya, who is qualified to know this text, this knowledge? What is the relationship between the text and the subject matter? What is the what is the purpose of this study, and what is the
relationship. So here it is told, Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta, Vedanta Siddhanta, Gratitam Nirmalam Shivam, Gratitam Nirmalam Shivam, Sadacharam Pravakshami,
Sadacharam
Pravakshami, Yoginam Jnana Siddhaye,
Yoginam Jnana Siddhaye.
I shall expound on the text Sadachar, dealing with the full import of the essence of the principle of Vedanta, that is identity between the self and Brahman, the nature of which is absolute purity and auspiciousness for the benefit of the seekers of self-knowledge. So, Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta, what is Sarva, all Vedanta, the knowledge of the oneness between the individual and the infinite. And what is Vedanta? I have already explained to you. Vedas are, the word is coming from Veda. What are Veda?
Scriptures.
Scriptures, the revealed scriptures. Yeah, thoda sa pankha meri tarah kar do, I'm all wet in that. It's not reaching me.
Just
either.
Tell it.
And I can increase the speed if you want.
Yeah.
Little bit more.
Open the
bus. So Vedanta is no kami karako, because otherwise it will disturb with the So Vedanta is the Vedas again. Majority of the people are only living for survival. So though majority of the people are not seeking the self, they are living for survival. So Vedas also, what are the tools for survival at the empirical level? They are given 70-80% of the Vedas is dealing with only that. How your desires can be satisfied, fulfilled. 70-80% of the Vedas is talking about, if you chant this mantra, you do this, you do that in the proper manner, you will get, you will, your desires or your wishes will be fulfilled. But when the angle of performance of those rituals, the attitude behind those rituals is changed, then suddenly a shift comes. One person in Melbourne, he was working and he became redundant because all manufacturing jobs were going. And for many years, 25 years, 20 years, first year itself he found me somewhere, and every year for Shankar Jayanti or somewhere he will call, and I used to go. And then one day he lost his job. He says, Swamiji, what should I do? And I used to go, I see he is doing all the pujas. I said, you become a pujari. You become a pujari. But then I added one more. Two people I did. One for was this, and just recently was one woman also. And she also learned from someone the pujas, and she came, Swamiji, today I am going for my first puja, give me Ashirvad. I said, Ashirvad is there, but the true Ashirvad that you will give yourself is, don't ask money for the puja, and make every puja a sadhana to be in communion with the divine. Don't do it for them. Whatever Lord has to give, he will give them. Make the sankalpa for them. You don't do the sankalpa. Make them do the sankalpa. But you keep your attention on the divine, that it's another opportunity the Lord is giving me to think about him. And that is what puja is. To serve him. To remember him. And now that lady, just before I came away, they come for Vedic chanting. Two, three ladies. And she said, after everyone went away, she stayed back. She said, Swamiji, I want to tell you something. I said, what? Swamiji, I am finding neeras ko kya bolte hain?
Dispassionate.
I am getting dispassionate of, she is very, very social.
Mm-hmm.
And she finds herself to be withdrawing from all these social activities. Is that okay? I said, you tell me. Is it normal? I said, no, because I go there, initially I am all ha ha hoo hoo and I start talking to them, and then suddenly within 2-3 minutes I feel, why am I getting caught up in all this? Why am I talking about same thing? Last gathering also I talked the same thing, now I am also talking the same thing. She bought this, I bought this jewelry, I bought that sari, I bought this, my children are like that, your children are like that, we are same topic. She says, now I'm not finding, and now even if they call me, I make some excuse and I don't go. Mm-hmm. What is happening? Because her interaction during the puja was of a healthy manner, it was not to earn money, it was not to do good to the world. I said, leave it that to the Lord. You make it your sadhana. Now it's 3 years now. In 3 years this transformation has come about. And it's good that she told me. Now I said, now if you don't want to go, don't go. But that spare time you spend in doing your own puja at home or doing japa. Don't go into depression. Otherwise mind is very smart. It will say, oh, I think people are rejecting me now. That should not happen. Because dispassion has to, once you withdraw from the world, you must have a higher goal where your attention goes. Otherwise you start again, you for a moment you get dispassionate and you start thinking, why nobody is calling me anymore? Before every day call is coming. She is very very social in her community, always the leader, but now suddenly she is in so many committees. But this year, last 6 months, she's just withdrawing from every. It's not that she's doing, she's just not inspired to be a part of it. Now, when you see someone unfolding in that manner, you also feel thrilled that he's moving in the right direction. And as long as she comes and takes guidance, you can give her the right direction. Otherwise, that person will go into depression. Because somewhere, the old habit will come in. Remember this. So yesterday the point was, old memories, old habits, old impressions cannot be removed from the mind. You cannot let go of anything. All you can do is create new ones which are stronger, more powerful than the previous ones. So they override the old program. But till realization, you have to remain alert and vigilant. Otherwise, any time that old program can shoot up its head. Many times in our life it must happen that I don't have this trait, I am not a jealous person, but suddenly that trait comes up. An unknown, it catches you unawares.
But can't you dissolve your...
No, you cannot. Mind is...
By taking the...
yes, yes. If you take the attention off it. So there are two ways. If you do it in the mind, you create a new program which is stronger. And what is the program you have created? I must take my attention away from it. I must put the attention on the self. I must put the attention that the whole world is an expression of the divine. That, yes, absolutely. Or I am the observer. The moment you come to be the witness, immediately the charge that is fueling it, fueling that negative trait, immediately it dissolves. Just like when you go to sleep every night, you become focused on the sleep and the whole charge that was keeping the waking world and keeping you active suddenly dissolves, isn't it? By itself. You don't do anything. You don't let go of the world when you go to sleep. Remember this. All you do is remain focused on the sleep and the world drops you. So the idea that I have to drop the world will lead to depression. It will lead to confusion. Our goal must be either the Lord or the self, consciousness. And this is what the scriptures are again and again. The Sarva Vedanta Siddha. This is the Siddhanta of the Vedas. So first part was, because majority are caught up in survival, 70-80% of the Vedas are talking about the various techniques, various rituals by which your desires can become satisfied. You want a child, No, I want only a boy. No, I have a boy now, I want a girl. You do the ritual correctly, you will conceive. You want rain, it will happen. You want money, it will happen. But it has to, lot of do's and don'ts are there to be able to fructify the result. But if your attention is on the higher, then automatically we wean off from that those rituals and we start seeing that the whole ritual can be done in our mind itself. We don't have to do it physically. Action, as we know it, it happens at three places, where manasa, vacha and kaya. So action means what? Movement. Movement is action, isn't it? So where is movement taking place? Thought. Words are changing one after the other, they are like a machine gun. And activity at the body level. Rituals, the havan, kund and puja, etc., that is happening at the body level. And sometimes our attention is only on, oh, why the old fruit is there, why the oil is less, why the utensils are not shining like before. Oh, we are lost in that only. Why this is here and not there. And anger and disturbance. You go to, I went to someone's house, while I was there, I took the magazine, I put it there, after reading. Immediately the husband comes, takes it and puts it back there. Then I am cheeky. So, as I was going around, I was taking something and putting, and after half an hour, everything is in its place. And then I went to the kitchen, I took the spoons and put it in the forks, and took the forks, put it in the spoons. Oh, he couldn't handle it after. Who is doing this? And I don't know him, I'm just playing. This, I'm just checking, what is your threshold? What is your threshold? That was our icebreaker. Then we became friends. Then comes the next majority portion of the Vedas. Now what is left? 20-30% is left. Out of that, 25%, 35% is the Upasana, where Om Sahasra Shirsha or the various suktas. Now you want to just chant those and your mind becomes focused and the whole puja happens in the mind only. You are not so much geared to do the physical. Doing the physical ritual is a distraction now, because you have to collect so many things. Now you are able, you chant the various mantras, and they are also compositions, big huge ones. I still haven't got around to learning everything. Because again and again, when I'm doing it, my attention is not on the words. My attention is, what are they talking about? And what are all these words? I say, immediately the thought, while I'm chanting, some mantras I know. So immediately while I'm chanting, the thought comes, they all come from Om. I said, why am I unnecessarily struggling with all these words? I'll just hold on to Om. And everything just dissolves away. And I come to chant Om only. Because what is our goal of life? Is it to become a master of all the chanting? Is it to become master of all the rituals? Is it to know all the different knowledges? But once we come to chant Om, and completely the result will be complete purification. As a result of that purification, wherever you put attention, the knowledge will just, it will be like an osmosis process. It will become yours without any trying. Without any trying. But if you are not purified, you try so much, you put effort so much, and still you are frustrated that, I don't know why I am not able to say it perfectly. I went to see one Mahatma in Ahmedabad. You know that you met. Remember when he chanted, I brought these girls, ladies, I said, chant Purusha Suktam in front of Swamiji. And they started chanting. And he was a musician. He was a musician. That's why he could sing those. But whatever, and he says, I never studied anything. And yet, his intonation of the various chantings, they were chanting Sahasra Shirsha Purusha, it was perfection. Perfection. And in madness, not insane. He was mad, as a crazy fellow. Hair everywhere, sits like that, doesn't care, he's just like this, and Om Sastra Shira Shaya. From there only he is chanting, without changing the position, but perfect intonation. Where does it? And we spent so many years trying to keep the cassette, learn and repeat with it. But when you come to the source, in one go, the knowledge comes to you. Krishna Bhagwan, Ramchandra ji, in 3 days they studied all the scriptures. 3 days, both of them, isn't it? Krishna Bhagwan to 3 days, Ramchandra ji also 3 or 4 days.
And then
Ramchandra ji then became the teacher for all his 3 brothers. Because he was so good. Once he has heard, he doesn't need a repetition. And we, after 10 years also, we are still trying to say, uske baad kya hai? Om Sah Sra Sa. Why? No purification. We are caught up in the words. Our attention must be on the what the words are indicating. What does indicating mean? If I say Chandrasekhar, will anyone else say, oh, he's talking about me? Will you say that? No, first thought, it is someone else's name. Then, oh, it is a male name. I am a female. And then it will say, oh, it sounds Tamilian. I am not Tamil. Suddenly, so many differences you will create in your mind. Only he will say, I. So that word, Chandrasekhar, is indicating him. Similarly, when we are talking about Om Sahasra Shirsha or the Durga Suktam or the Narayan Suktam or whatever, whom are we talking about? Some entity above the clouds? Or is it about our own essential nature? When attention is there, when the bhav is there, the focus is there, then purification happens. When the attention is only on the throat, on getting the right intonation, then purification doesn't happen. And when purification happens, this is inevitable. The moment your mind is exposed to the Upanishads, that is the last 2-3% of the Vedas. They are for the Jnanis. Those who have weaned away from the rituals, those who have weaned away from Upasana. Upasana was, they know there is something higher and they are looking up towards it. But now, as a result of purification, they have come to understand that what I am seeking, I am. But what is the process of that? Then they come to the Upanishads to get the clarity about it. And when they come to it, when you listen to it, at that very moment, it strikes a chord within your heart and mind that what is being talked about by the Upanishads, I am. Not through the mind, essentially. And in this way, Sarva Vedanta Siddhanta. Gratitam Nirmalam Shivam. And identity, knowledge of the self, it is Nirmalam. There is no mala. There is no impurity ever possible. Just like a snake cannot create impurity in a rope, similarly, individuality cannot create impurity in that infinite reality that I essentially am. The whole creation cannot corrupt the reality. Cannot corrupt the reality. Now make it subjective. Where is the world? Where is the creation? in my mind? Where are the thoughts? In my mind. Where is the knowledge? In my mind. Where is the ignorance? In the mind. All this should not corrupt the self that I am, the observer that I am, the eternal witness that I am. If you want to put it in a larger scope, all the thoughts of the waking and the waking world, dream world, and the absence of them, they do not corrupt the conscious principle that I am. Nirmalam, Shivam. And this is the most auspicious. And therefore, those who are established in it, even videos make us feel good about ourselves. When we listen to Ravana Maharshi, when we listen to Sadguru, when we come across masters, by merely, just like when you come in the presence of fire, you will feel the warmth. Even though you have not become, you are not putting your hand in the fire. But you feel the warmth, isn't it? Exactly the same way. You come in the presence of the sun, sunshine, you come out of the room, come out, ah, vitamin D. You come in the presence of a master who's established in this knowledge, there and then, at that very instant, spontaneously, you will feel you are in the presence of auspiciousness. Why, how, all goes out of the window. And that auspiciousness is your essential nature. Reclaim it, be it. Don't objectify it. Don't search for it in the books. Don't search for it in the satsangs. Don't search for it in the temples. Search for it in yourself. This mistake we are doing. And many of us are seeking it in ourselves, but we are seeking it objectively. We are seeking it through the mind. The journey must result in dissolution of the mind. And for that these words are given. When the mind starts thinking Nirmalam, my nature is Nirmal, I am absolutely pure, and purity means, first it will think no thoughts is purity. No thoughts is purity, it will go into Nirvikalpa Samadhi. He will try to bring it about. But when he comes to the Upanishads, thought or no thought, I am independent of that. Then Sahaj Samadhi comes. Nirmalam. And to be transcendental to the thought that I am Nirmal, or there is no thought also, one has to take that position. Shivam, auspiciousness. Sadacharam pravakshami yogi namnyana siddhaye. So the Shankaracharya is saying, pravakshami, I am going to speak about, talk about sadachar. Sadachar, I have already told, it is the spiritual conduct how a seeker will do the various acts of the day, and how what is the disposition of a wise one when he is doing the same. And if we can look, wise one does not have to do anything in life. But if he had to do, what will be his angle of interaction with it? That will be seen. And here the next word is yogi nam. Yogi nam is what? Yogi is invoking the potentiality within you. Yoga means, we know. What does yoga mean? Union between the self and the total, or the infinite, jivatma and paramatma. But for that purpose, our understanding has become yogi means the one who is doing various pranayam, asanas, pratyahar, dharana, dhyan, samadhi. For what purpose? For gaining siddhis, for gaining power, for suppressing the mind. We are not talking about that yogi. Here the yogi means the one who is wanting to, or recognizes that which he is seeking is the one, because that will be the disposition of the wise one. And what is the seeker thinking? That I have to do something in order to become with the one that I, that reality. So two dispositions. Ignorant, though, we are putting him out of the picture. He is only involved in the world. Seeker, he is thinking the reality is separate to him, so I must do sadhana, I must do exercises, I must do concentration, I must raise kundalini, I must learn scriptures, I must do nididhyasan, etc., etc., shravanam, mananam, nididhyasan. It's all creating a journey. It's all creating a journey where there is no journey. What is the disposition of the jnani or the wise one? That I am already that which I am seeking. Story over. So what sadhana will he do? Nothing. It's he is effortlessly abiding in that. Seeker is putting efforts to become effortless. Because he wants to reach effortlessness. Yogi naam, kya tha aage? Jnana siddhe. And coming to this disposition alone will give us the abidance in the knowledge. Knowledge is not thought knowledge. Knowledge is not conceptual knowledge. Knowledge is not knowledge in the mind. Knowledge is abidance in the self. We'll take from here in our next class. Is it time or? Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachaye Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Anyway, it was the